Good evening. Sydney is a city on tenterhooks tonight, with Christmas plans on hold as we await an announcement from the Premier on what celebrations will look like. But all the figures suggest the Northern Beaches outbreak is trending in the right direction. New cases are in the single digits, even after a record-breaking 24 hours of testing.
Closing a loophole that threatened our defences against COVID, international airline crews greeted by police on arrival and given the same treatment as a returned traveller. They were placed on buses and transferred to two new quarantine hotels in Mascot, where they will remain under guard until their return flights.
Over time, we've realised that that hasn't worked completely well all the time, and so we've become stricter on that.
And as health officials plugged one leak, another emerged today as the Premier and her Chief Health Officer broke down all the important numbers which will decide how we celebrate Christmas.
Can I first thank more than 44,000 people that came forward to testing yesterday in New South Wales. That is a record we did not expect.
And just eight new cases was a nice surprise. Seven linked to the Avalon cluster, but the eighth, a worrying development. A nurse from Western Sydney working at the airport.
We are aware that they transported a symptomatic family of three from the airport on the 14th of December.
The family had flown in from the US, and there'll be confirmation in tomorrow's numbers the nurse has infected a fellow worker. In the 6 days since COVID-19 made its run on the northern beaches, the task was to try and keep it there. But there has been a breakout. A diner at the Rose of Australia Hotel in Erskineville passing it on to another patron they didn't know.
I don't think any system can ever guarantee that we won't have any transmission events.
The contact tracing teams in overdrive, hundreds of venues have been visited by the 90 cases linked to the Avalon cluster. A roll call of restaurants, hotels, supermarkets, cafes and gyms from the beaches to the suburbs all over Sydney.
I think we're 9 days in.
Lachlan Westhoff from Glebe is one of the many, many thousands of people who'll spend Christmas in isolation, all because he visited his parents.
Planned on spending the weekend in Avalon, went to the gym in the morning, and here we are.
And while a Christmas locked up is locked in for those in isolation, the rest of us will learn tomorrow what's in store from Christmas Eve and beyond.
At the moment, the trend is going where we want it to go, where we need it to go.
Another single-digit day tomorrow could well be the best present we could ask for.
Damien Ryan joins me now. And Damo, the Premier's been forced to make some very tough decisions since this pandemic began, and tomorrow's might be the toughest.
D-Day, Georgie. No doubt she doesn't want to cancel Christmas, and the signs are that she won't. If the numbers stay low, there's no way the Premier could tighten things further. It's more likely she may stick with the restrictions we have or ease them and make Christmas better than we thought. Let's hope it's that one.
Indeed.
Georgie.
Thank you, Damo. Let's go to Lauren Tomasi now, who joins us from The Spit. And Lauren, residents on either side of that bridge could be having very different festivities come Friday.
Yeah, Georgie, the Premier's decision on Christmas will directly impact all 250,000 residents on this side of the Spit Bridge. If lockdown stays in place, then Christmas festivities will be at a bare minimum. It is a different story, though, just a couple of hundred metres on the other side of the bridge where the North Shore begins and restrictions are at a minimum. Tonight, the hope is that we can get this COVID cluster under control. Car after car lined up at Manly this morning. The Northern Beaches up early and residents setting records for testing.
We arrived around 6 a.m.
When I go to the Sydney cricket tests at the cricket ground, I get there at 4:30 a.m. in the morning and I'm a member and I'm still 100 metres down the line.
The peninsula hit 100,000 COVID swabs today, a community banding together to just maybe beat this in time for Christmas.
Yeah, I expected some aggressive behaviour. We saw none. Everybody's been absolutely fantastic.
Thank you, Sydney. Thank you, Northern Beaches community. How good is it we're all coming out in such numbers?
The local council playing its part, checking in on residents over 70 in lockdown.
They're out there at the moment. There's about 16,000 people on our list that we're calling out just to check on them.
Metin and Khan of Manly Kebab have been here 22 years. They say they've never seen the area this quiet. For businesses like theirs, more testing and fewer cases is now bringing some festive hope.
Finger crossed, I hope everything's getting better, back to normal, because Christmas time for everyone.
On the third day of lockdown, police are a visible presence around the beaches, a gentle pat for a pooch on Manly Corso, and then a gentle nudge for people breaking the rules by using beachside benches and park seats.
Okay, no worries, good, thanks.
A softly, softly approach in contrast to some officers yesterday at Bondi, where a number of drivers queuing for COVID tests were fined for using their phones behind the wheel.
Nine people were in that category, seven of which have now been reverted to a caution. So seven of those fines have been revoked, but I understand for two of those fines there were additional issues. So common sense prevailed.
Up and down the northern beaches, the feeling is hopeful. The community has really rallied behind this lockdown, and so far, it seems to be working. For now, the entire peninsula counting down, masking up, and hoping for a Merry Christmas. Lauren Tomasi, Nine News.
A teenage girl who returned home to Melbourne after visiting the northern beaches has tested positive to COVID-19. Victoria's health minister has used the case to defend the state's tough stance on closing the border with New South Wales.
A choke point on our southern border, every car and truck checked before being allowed to cross. But days before this border closure, a 15-year-old girl and her parent crossed freely back into Victoria, having visited family on the northern beaches. By then, it was already a COVID hot zone.
Given the family was isolating at home, at this point, there are no known exposure sites in Victoria.
The family did stop halfway at Oliver's Real Food in Gundagai, customers turning up today to find it closed. After arriving home, the team tested positive, validating Victoria's hard line.
Given the importance of this case and now 53 days of community-free Victorian transmission, we are putting every available resource and effort into keeping those 53 days going.
But that hard line is having hard consequences. Truck drivers say without a dedicated transit lane, delays of up to 5 hours at the border are now putting Christmas deliveries at risk.
We've got professional men and women drivers who are trying to manage their fatigue. They are essentially working hours whilst they're in that vehicle. The knock-on effect of that towards the back end of the week in the lead-up to Christmas could mean that we have got trucks that don't get home for Christmas.
Businesses in the border towns are also struggling again. This restaurant in Wodonga now losing customers from the New South Wales side of the border.
Today we were meant to be super busy, we were meant to be booked out for dinner, so we've gone from super busy to, you know, not so busy. I'm having to actually cancel staff.
And in what should be one of this cake shop's busiest weeks of the year,
getting bombarded with phone calls this morning saying that, you know, can you deliver our order because, you know, last night people are stuck in traffic for 3.5 hours.
To the north, Queensland has now introduced a hard border with all of New South Wales barriers installed last night. More than 100 people have been turned away, including one woman who tried to cross into Queensland.
We'll allege that she told us she wasn't from a hotspot. We had methods of establishing she was, so we turned her around.
She then tried at a second checkpoint.
We'll allege again that she lied to police and she was issued with a $4,003 fine.
For others, it's a complication they just don't need.
We just live about 200 yards across the border. Now it's going to take me about 2 hours to get to work.
In South Australia, the health minister under fire after Sydney passengers were wrongly told to turn around or quarantine, even though they'd arrived before the cutoff. He's now considering compensation.
We all regret what's happened. We all apologise for what's happened. What we're focused on doing now is to facilitate Christmas where we can.
At a deserted Sydney airport, it was quiet enough for an undisturbed nap. A handful of travellers trying to get home, Anthony Ball and his family among them, now facing quarantine when they return to Cairns.
If it keeps Australia safe and we get the country back up and running, well, it's a small price to pay, isn't it, really? And we've got each other, so we're happy.
Eddie Meyer, Nine News.
Yeah. Let's go now to Liz Gwynn on the border at Wodonga. And Liz, how's the traffic there right now?
The traffic is bumper to bumper, Georgie. Motorists have endured this for 2 days now and they're already sick of it. Some describing it as a nightmare, others describing it as one disaster after another. Now, traffic is flowing better at this Albury-Wodonga checkpoint today, but we have faced long delays. I mean, just on the Wodonga Highway, on the Hume Highway, I should say, traffic delays were about an hour, and then at this Albury-Wodonga checkpoint, it's about the same. So there are repeated calls to move this border either further south or north, but so far they've fallen on deaf ears. Georgie?
OK, Liz, thank you. There could be more disappointing news about Sydney's world-famous New Year's Eve fireworks, with calls now for the event to be cancelled in light of the recent outbreak. Nine's Kate Creedon's at Kirribilli for us tonight. And, Kate, what's the likelihood the fireworks will be called off?
Well, Georgie, Sydney's Lord Mayor isn't convinced we can ring in the new year in a COVID-safe way. Clover Moore is concerned about overcrowding and says if the event cannot be held safely, it should not go ahead. The state government, on the other hand, is adamant that the current plan of a scaled-back 7-minute firework display at midnight will go ahead. However, there could be some changes to restrictions, particularly around how many people will be allowed into vantage points to maintain social distancing and how many people we can have in our homes. Now, as we know, this is on the agenda at a meeting tomorrow, but as we've seen, a lot can change in a week, so we may not know exactly how we'll be celebrating until the very last minute. Georgie?
Kate Creedon, thank you. More than 40 countries have now imposed travel bans on the UK as fears grow over the new, more contagious strain of COVID-19. The border closures are causing chaos at airports and ports, leaving travellers stranded and raising fears of food shortages.
Cancelled flights in Madrid, Geneva, Berlin. It's the nightmare before Christmas for the UK. Dozens of countries have now turned their backs on Britain, shutting borders and issuing travel bans as global panic peaks over the mutated, more contagious strain of COVID-19. Airports filled with passengers desperate to get home.
It was more like almost like a ticking time bomb, because we didn't know whether it was going to close immediately or when it was going to close.
At Germany's Hanover Airport, a plane load of travellers from the UK was forced to sleep in the terminal, barred from leaving until they tested negative.
I want to stress that we in the UK fully understand the anxieties of our friends about COVID, their anxieties about the new variant.
And in the US, where UK flights are still allowed, the New York governor demanded and won new mandatory testing for British Airways flights into JFK Airport.
If the UK believes the strain is so serious that Boris Johnson, who said the week before, we're not going to cancel Christmas, we're not going to close, did a 180-degree turn and then closed parts of the UK, it's serious, my friends.
With the French borders still closed to freight, England's port of Dover sat eerily empty. Truck drivers stranded in a stalemate not of their making, as fresh produce in many of the vehicles goes to waste.
I take freight to Britain and I can't go back home.
Those queues at ports leading to queues at shops and some supermarkets warned of potential shortages of fruit and vegetables. That sparked panic buying like London hasn't seen for months as people stock up for Christmas.
All this with the impending Brexit deadline mere days away. In London, Kari-Anne Greenbank, Nine News.